G'day, so today we're making a basic open crumb white sourdough. It's a 2 kilo dough, takes about roughly 36 hours from start to finish. You get a reasonably good open crumb. There's no mixing in terms of a machine, just by hand. And this bread will give you that kind of crust. It's pretty nice. Starting from the beginning, we have a chunk of Dessem or dough starter in our kneading container. To that we add water, and I've got a little potato masher there that's helping to break it up. And that's what it looks like when it's starting to hydrate. That's making a milk. Next, we're adding flour to the hydrated dough starter. And so that's one part flour to one part water. In this case, 500 mils of water, 500 grams of flour, and 50 grams of that dough starter. Now we want to mash it up using our potato masher, and that's what it all looks like when it's finished. So that's your pre-ferment right there. Now the pre-ferment is allowed to ripen for a full 24 hours. I generally let it go for a few hours out of the fridge, and then I put it in the fridge overnight so that when I come to make dough out of it, it's nice and cool. Next day, comes out of the fridge. We add 600 grams more flour, 300 mils more water, and about 30 grams of salt. I've just used regular cooking salt, but you can use any fine salt that you like. That salt, to get it through the dough, you've got to push it right through using your fingers. That's called docking. And what that's doing is making little tubes or little tunnels of salt that help it to distribute more evenly through the dough. At this point, you can take your dough out of the container and dock it out on the bench nice and flat like I've done here. Starting with the edge furthest away from you, gather it up and start rolling it over so you're creating essentially a cylinder of dough. The first few times you do this turn, the dough is very, very rough, so you can't really stretch it much. So it's just a matter of rolling it into a cylinder, bring it back towards you, and docking it out again flat on the table. Repeat the process. So once it's flat, you take the edge furthest away from you, roll it back using your thumbs, and then you end up with another cylinder. You turn it through 90 degrees, flip it over so the seam is back on the top. Always work with the seam into yourself like that. And once that's been done up to 10 times, this whole process, you'll find that your dough progressively becomes smoother and brighter because it's oxygenating. I recommend you progressively use more parts of your body to knead, for example, your knuckles and even your elbows, to get that dough to stretch, and you'll find that you can put more and more stretch into it as you go along. Another handy technique is to simply allow the dough to rest by rounding it in a ball like I've done here. Now at this stage, you can see the dough is beginning to get a little bit shiny. What I'll tend to do though is to spray it with some water and leave it on the bench, and then I put my plastic container that I've been using to knead the dough in over the top of the dough to keep it moist and to stop it from crusting. Once the dough has had a good long rest, probably about a half an hour or so, chop a little chunk of it off about the size of a golf ball. Take that ball, round it off in your fingers, between your thumbs and your fingers, and then begin to stretch it out. This is called a window test. Once you've got one layer of gluten exposed through your window test, you hold that up to the light and you look for what's called shagginess. Essentially, we want to clear the window, so you can stretch it out to be this one layer thick of gluten, and when you hold it up to the light, you could just about see through it. In our example here, the gluten's looking pretty good. I've decided to give it another couple of turns while it's rested, and then when I'm finished there, it'll go back in the tub for the first proof. The first proof is also known as the bulk proof, also sometimes called the primary proof. This proof generally takes, in room temperatures, somewhere in the vicinity of 4 to 6, possibly 8 hours. And at the end of that time, you'll notice that the dough has filled the tub very nicely. Here's the dough after a few hours, and I've given it what I call a poke test. Now, doing a poke test is quite an illuminating exercise. You'll notice that if your dough isn't ripe, the hole that you've poked in it with your finger will close up very quickly. On the other hand, if the dough is ripe, the hole will stay open for some considerable period of time, and this tells us that it's time to move on to the next stage. This involves removing the dough from the container again and rounding it up on the bench so that it has a smooth surface, chopping it down the middle and rounding both of those balls again, and putting them back in the tub for their second proof. The second proof is a very important proof. Just for the record, it's about half the length of the first proof. So if your first proof was about 4 hours, second proof will be about 2 hours. After a couple of hours, the two balls of dough that you put back in the tub will have pretty much regassed and they'll have filled the tub, and you can give them another quick poke test to check that they're ripe. And again, if the hole you poke stays open for a minute or two after you've poked it and it doesn't look like it's going to close too quickly, then I'd say that it's ready. Once you've established that your second proof is complete and the dough is nice and ripe, you can remove those balls of dough from the tub and roll them into cylinders. Once you've shaped your cylinders, you need to dust a regular breadboard, large-ish, with quite a lot of coarse grit semolina or polenta. This is so that your dough doesn't attach itself to the boards while it's having its final third proof. It's a good idea to move the cylinder-shaped balls onto the breadboard with wet hands. That way, the surface of the dough will be wet when it gets there. You're going to want to dust some more of this coarse grit semolina or possibly even rye flour over the top of the dough. Nice and thick. Now, our finished dough wants to rest without it crusting up. By placing these two plastic tubs over the top of the dough as they rest on the breadboard and go into their final proof. Because these plastic tubs seal the dough inside them while they're sitting on the breadboards, they begin to warm up and they act like a little mini proofer. While the dough is having its final proof, it's time to prepare the oven. You can see I've added a bit of thermal mass to my home oven here. These are planter bases from my local nursery, and they provide a surface for me to set the dough on. Now it's time to preheat the oven. Set the oven to 250 degrees and wait. Now that everything should be ready to go and your baking temperature should be around 250 at this point, take those ripened chunks of dough, slash them with a sharp knife in whatever pattern floats your boat, and peel them directly onto the stones in the oven. You'll notice that there's a second terracotta pot base, which is actually positioned right way up above where the dough has been set. That terracotta pot base is full of water and gives us steam. The steam helps with the kick in the oven, or the oven spring. It also provides us with crust colour, so it's a very important thing to use. Every 15 minutes or so, check your dough, which will be kicking quite nicely now. Often it's a good idea to rotate the dough on the spot using your oven gloves and a peel, although I have to admit I don't, because my hands are made of asbestos. Doing this will ensure an even bake. Keep checking and rotating as required. The total time the bread will take in the oven varies according to a number of factors, not the least of which is to do with the quality of the oven. You may find that your oven is so powerful that you need to wind the temperature down after the first 15 minutes. Some ovens struggle to get the right temperature at any time. I'm generally happy if those stones are heated above 200 degrees. So after about half an hour or so, it's worth taking the dough out and having a quick check. It probably won't be cooked, but often you will get a good idea as to how long it'll still need in the oven. People get a bit timid on their ovens. It's actually well worth, just if you've got a lot of thermal mass in there, like I've done with mine, the dough will tend to cook much more thoroughly. These two in my oven took an hour and 20 minutes. As you can see, I like to go for a full coloured crust. I don't think pallid is a wonderful thing. So there you have it, the 36 hour white sourdough sole baked in the home oven. You can see that the process is pretty simple and really involves a lot less work than you think. It just takes a bit of time. Good bread always takes time. The longer you can ferment dough, the better. But in this case, we pretty much did most of the work in an 8 hour period after the pre-ferment had ripened. To summarize, I'll just quickly go through what we've done so far. We took the dough through three proofs and prepared it to bake. We set up our oven, adding thermal mass and moisture for steam. We preheated the oven for an hour, allowing enough time for that thermal mass to soak. Once that had occurred, we put it in the oven and rotated at 15 minute intervals. We ended up with a good coloured crust and a lovely loaf of bread.